The next speaker that we have is a traveler, a storyteller, a mapper. Siddharth Agarwal walks across the country to collect critical map points and experiences. He is here to share his side story on how the process of an on-ground mapping differs from automated mapping and how walking and mapping has given him a very different perception about life and world. And I'd also request the next speaker to please come by the dais. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Siddharth, and I introduced that video at the beginning to give a sense of what I'm going to talk about. Of course, I'm going to talk about walking, it's clear, but just from what you saw, I don't think it gives enough context, and that's the second part about what I'm going to talk, is context. So walking and context, I think that those are the two things that I'm going to talk about. Of course, maps. So this is again, I mean, this lines on a paper, on a screen, something. But if I add a map to it, or add it to a map, that makes for a route, a trail. So that's basically my trail over the past 4 years walking across India. So all the trails that you see here is, I've walked them over 5,000 kilometers in the past few years. And doing this has given me an immense amount of context to everything that I was looking at from up above, using maps, using satellite imagery, using drones. And that is exactly what I want to talk about. Walking. This is a picture from the banks of the Ganga, somewhere in Uttar Pradesh. It's very difficult to, if I did not have mentioned that this was from where it was, I've asked this question to a lot of people and gotten blank responses, and people having even said that this is not from this country, or definitely not from Uttar Pradesh. And which is interesting, because this is a place that you cannot reach by a car. This is a place you need to walk to reach. And we are at a mapping conference. It's interesting that since yesterday, and maybe I sound like an anarchist, but walking being the oldest form of mapping and understanding the land, nobody has talked about it except the last session we had last night, where we heard storytellers who literally walk the land, who know the land, who understand the topography. And that is a memory of the land that is intrinsic, because even from the first ancestors of humans, we have discovered this world on foot, walking, right from Ethiopia all the way till Tierra del Fuego in South America. We have discovered this world on foot, looking at it very intimately. But since yesterday, all the discussion that we've had, 90% of it, maybe 95% of it, talks only about roads. There's more to this earth than just roads. Shashank showed the same map in a different form. This is the global roadless area patches. This is taken from a study from 2016, which uses OSM data for the roads to calculate what are the parts of the world which are at what proximity from a major road. And if you look at, this is part of a bigger map, and if you look at India, there are still patches which, this is an old map. If you update it, the yellows will increase and the reds will increase. And walking in my experience, has taken me to places that are blue. It's very interesting, it's that all of our lives with all this technology has limited us into invisible tunnels, in these invisible tunnels around the roads. And we refuse to look at anything that is interestingly outside these invisible tunnels. What happens when we look outside these invisible tunnels, what happens outside those invisible tunnels is something that we as mappers, I think, should be very interested in, because the same way that we map and we talk about everything that you talked about, from service delivery to infrastructure, there's a lot of stuff happening and not happening there because they're not mapped. I was walking across Bundelkhand last month, and this was on the road instead of being off the road, and we found something very interesting. We called it road fossils. There were trucks, there were all these roads where repair work was going on, and because the roads were small roads, the traffic couldn't be stopped on those roads. So the workers there, they put the closest available leaf from the trees or the grass onto the hot tar, so that the hot tar wouldn't stick on passing by cars. And that created something very beautiful, these road fossils. And this was the first encounter, and then there was another encounter, and then there was another encounter, and it kept on going, and it looked beautiful. Of course, it was very interesting. But if I put it onto a map, if I put this information onto a map, and then add context, it starts making so much more sense. If you look at the map, this is a river, this is a river, and there are smaller rivers here that you probably can't make out from back there. All the roads that we saw with these road fossils, they were all in that condition because of sand mining. I would not have made that connection just by driving on that road. But further down that road, we went off the road and went to the river, and that's where we saw this. And it's interesting because we're talking about conservation, we're talking about how maps are useful for conservation. These trucks are running overweight beyond the capacity that they're allowed to, and they keep destroying the roads. So we have to keep building the roads again. And this process continues. So we can use maps to create accountability on sand mining. We can use maps to understand the observations of daily life. But in these invisible tunnels that we're talking about, where we're talking about improving efficiency and improving time and reducing dependencies, reducing variables, what's happening there is something that we're clearly missing out on. And that brings me to one of the walks that I had done along the River Ken. And this is in the upper stretches of the river, where if you can see, I mean, there's not much water there. It's like a small puddle. You walk about 100 meters ahead of this place, and the water vanishes. And again, you'll find another puddle again. It's interesting, and why I'm talking about context again and again, is this river, it goes about 100 kilometers downstream and enters a national park, and we as a country want to put a dam on this river and take water from this river where we think it's surplus to another river which is nearby. The people who are taking these decisions are not here. The people who are taking these decisions are looking at a map and making those decisions, which makes our job as people who make maps very important, because if we leave out the context of what we are mapping, the people using those maps will take that as the truth and take action accordingly. So our responsibility as mappers of whatever we map becomes so much more important, that this could be misleading on a map, because the people who are supposed to take decisions, they're not coming onto the ground, they're not coming onto the field. And our responsibility is to make them, I mean, I don't expect them to come onto the field, like, that's, I'm not even hopeful about that. But as mappers, this is the whole top, bottom, and bottom-up approach, that we can, as mappers, be on the field as well and somehow find a way to add context. Here is where I wanted to reach out for help. And while I'm walking, I'm trying to document and collect as much data as I can, different kinds of information, which I will share with you. But what I do at the end of each day is I make notes. And I make schematic notes. I draw the route that I've walked according to what I think the route was, and then make observations about land use, about sightings that we've had that day. And when I'm stuck is transforming this information that I've observed on ground. How can I use open source tools to take this information and digitize it? I've been trying. I will share that with you in a couple of slides. But this, as a system of field mapping, is something that I've been trying to do. And I would really appreciate if, as a community of mappers, we could think more about how we can take field information and digitize it easily. Because my work is not just data. I'm a storyteller as well. And stories come in all forms. It comes as a visual. It comes as an audio. It comes as a physical texture. It comes as an oral sensation. It comes as taste. And this is taste. This is ice cream in a village where there's no roads. So the ice cream wala comes in a cycle with a thermocoil box behind him. And that's the icicles that we had in the village after a long day of walk. And that sensation of taste in my head brings me back to that field memory to be able to tell a story more intimately. And I think that kind of deep storytelling or deep emotion is what I'm talking about, that can help contextualize a lot of our maps and make them or democratize. That I think that sensation can democratize what we are doing sitting here in these rooms. This is, again, a collection of natural history elements from my trail that I later actually touch and feel and use this to look back at the trail and recollect memories to tell a story. But what I'm going to show you next is some of the data points that I had collected from the Ken, the walk that I've been talking about. And I'd want to show you the map where and we've got all these layers that talk about the different kind of observations that we've made. I'll just scroll through. If you're interested in any of the observations, you can just shout out and ask me to stop. I can show you that the point, it's geotagged, and there's a picture on it, and there's probably some notes on it as well. We hope to open this data up so that more people can see this, learn from it, and more importantly, don't duplicate. They can build on this information. We need to, that's what we've been talking about, that how do, and that's my question or appeal to everyone here as well, that if you can help how to do this on an open platform and in a format in which people can build over this information instead of duplicating the same work again. So I'm just scrolling through this. If anybody is interested in anything, I'll just pick a random point. This one? So sadly, that's a report of a crocodile spotting. And we didn't see the crocodile ourselves. But yeah, there's a note as well. And the challenge that I face while doing this work is how to better tag this information to be able to give the opportunity to more people to build upon this. So I'll go back and try and anything. Okay, 1 second. I think it's slightly slow. Okay, so you can see it here. It'll load up if you click on it. So yeah, if I'll open up this map for today and give you a link to browse through it. and I have to close it again because I can't keep it open too long for now, before I complete the map and then open it for you to see. So if someone wants to look at it, you can come after the talk and look at it. And yeah, that's pretty much brings me to the end of my presentation, that it's my appeal that we look at areas that are not along roads, we look at geography, also look at geography that is away from roads, because this is kind of a digital colonization. It's happening both for us and the people living on ground, because we're smashing them with layers of information that they're not aware of at all. And we're changing their memory, we're changing their culture by renaming things. Something as simple as renaming, which we now know very clearly, has a lot of power of changing narrative. So as technologists who have an idea and an open mind towards democratizing mapping, I think we should be very careful about that. So thank you.